Hello, it's the first Tuesday in April. My name is Patricia Aiken, and I'm delighted to be your host today. We are going to be talking about a topic that I'm not even sure how to introduce, and I'll just say how I learned about it. My friend Michelle Johnson has a show on Monday nights, and we often trade guests. Some people that have been on my show, I send them over to her show, and she's on All Talk Radio. And a month ago, I tuned in just to be my supportive self as usual, and she announced this topic, and inside, I started screaming. I'm like, no, don't do this. Don't do this. And then she introduced her guest, and I had to start listening because he was making a lot of sense. And then I watched his videos, and I had some, I have to say mental indigestion about some of the things that he was pointing out, and I still have some things about that. But I started looking into this topic, and I say I've been kind of enthralled by it ever since. And you'd have a hard time convincing me otherwise now. And so our topic today is the Earth flat? And has that been hidden from us? And my guest is Mark Sargent. Welcome, Mark.
Hi, Patricia. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, he has a series of videos out, and they've been very popular, very, very smoothly done. They were the first ones I watched, and so I'm grateful, but unfortunately, it was worse than potato chips, Mark. Once I finished with yours, I had to go through all the rest of them.
And there are a few out there.
Yeah, and I was kind of surprised by that, because I figured, oh, there's got to be maybe three or four people talking about this, but there's a whole lot more than that.
Yeah.
And you've been in a real firestorm here lately, and so I'm going to ask you the hard questions today.
Sure, go ahead.
Okay, sure. So let's start where you live, where you're from, how you got into this.
I am currently in Boulder, Colorado. I was born and raised, though, on Whidbey Island, Washington. Moved out here for a computer gaming job back in 95 and stayed in the Boulder tech sector for 20 years. Was kind of in and out of conspiracies for a number of years, the garden variety stuff. Well, I call them garden variety now, and kind of got burned out. I was like, is there anything new out there? And there was one that was still on the shelf that I wouldn't touch, never was going to touch. And that was it came after the hollow earth theory. And that was, flat earth theory. And I initially thought I could just burn through it in a weekend. And so 9 months ago, I kind of dug into it and, watched, some of the videos that were out there. And there weren't a lot at the time. It really seemed to have picked up in the last, 2015. But about 8 weeks ago, I just woke up, in the middle of the night and had just this moment of clarity where the narrative was just sitting in my head, and I started creating the Flat Earth Clues series. Initially, I just was going to do a guide and maybe a clue or two, and then before you knew it, I had 7 out there, and now it's up to 11, and that's where I am now. So I initially set out to prove the globe. To prove that, that we were on a sphere and everybody was nobody was lying to us, and NASA was completely legit. And before it was over, it may not be perfectly flat depending on who you talk to, but it is not a globe in my opinion.
No, no way is it a globe.
No.
And, so let's see. The Earth is turning at 1,000 miles an hour.
Yep.
Okay. And the water doesn't run off anywhere. It's all because we have this magic Velcro atmosphere.
Yeah.
Okay. Because really, without that magic Velcro atmosphere, and what do people tell you about that?
Well, there's a big question out there, and that is, if the vacuum of space is such a strong force, we've all seen, what vacuum can do down here, then why isn't it, you're telling me that huge pull of the vacuum of space hasn't pulled the atmosphere, just ripped it clean off? And people say, well, it's because of gravity, and what you said, it's part of a a giant Velcro system, and I don't buy it. I can't. It's because at that point there'd be this weird little membrane where vacuum and atmosphere have this equilibrium, and I just don't see it.
Well, I don't see that either. Mark, we have the conspiracies all have naysayers, but more importantly, there's controlled opposition that's within them. And lately you've been being labeled controlled opposition.
That is true.
Okay. And why that is. And so maybe I want to give you an opportunity to talk about this today, and maybe you know, just dispel some things, or maybe dig yourself in deeper. I'm not sure.
Hopefully not, but I, you know, I watched it from hour one when it happened. As a matter of fact, it came kind of out of the blue for me as well. I had somebody contact me and said that Eric Dubé was starting up his, you know, his own society that was separate from the Flat Earth Research. I'm sorry, Flat Earth Society, which was called the Flat Earth Research Society. And that he was really upset about one of the first interviews that I had done. And so I looked into it, and I was really busy that day, and I read the post. And basically what had happened was, he was, from what I could tell, everybody was on board with the clues. That was fine. And then when I did the first couple interviews, and I know one of them was Michelle's, I mentioned that when it came to the moon, because people were asking me about the moon and, you know, how I refer to it, I said, look, if you want to see some weird stuff about the moon, you know, please look at Crow 777's videos, because he takes, in my opinion, probably the best HD video of what's on the moon, you know, and from, even though he's not a flat earther, I said, look, you know, if you want to cast doubt on the moon, watch his stuff. And Eric really, really took offense to that. And he basically said, look, you really shouldn't mention him. And I, you know, was like, okay, why not? And he goes, well, because he's controlled opposition. And I was going, well, I haven't heard this, you know, anywhere. I haven't read it anywhere. But I, you know, I'm going to keep referring to him, because I still think he's the best stuff out here. If you've got better stuff, I'd be more than happy to use it. In fact, one of Eric's friends caught me in a roundtable and asked me that very question. And I said, you know, I'd more than happy to use whatever you got, but it's got to be better than his. And so we were kind of at an impasse for a while. And then somebody, you know, a guy came to me and says, look, you know, because I still to this day will not say anything bad about Eric in an interview. And he said, it looks like Eric might be retracting some of his stuff. And I go, great, fantastic. So I went straight to Eric's YouTube page. I went to his discussion page and I said, look, glad to know, you know, that we're, you know, sharing some same points, and we don't see eye to eye, but, you know, let's try to move forward. And it looked like things were kind of patching up. And then Matt from the NASA channel released his, you know, 2.5 hour opus of stuff where he said, no, you know, Mark can't be trusted. And then Eric comes out with his video, and then Cesar, you know, he came out with his video, and then he retracted that. But, you know, that's all happened within the last 3 or 4 days.
Yeah, so now listen, Mark, let's clear this up.
Sure.
Because I've heard you say I've been tracking all your interviews and whatnot.
Sure.
You know, I'm one of those people dig down to bedrock. I was that kid that read the biography, the autobiography, the unauthorized biography, the authorized biography. I'm just that kind of weirdo. Okay. Mm-hmm. And you're saying that you're communicating with Eric Dubé?
That not directly. I mean, if he's got an email address, I'd love to email him directly. But he's got.
But I know he answers everything on Facebook. The IFERS, the International Flat Earth Research Society.
Yep.
Forum. You've been invited there. I know you're invited there. And he says he told me just 2 days ago that you haven't contacted him.
If he wants to contact me, he's got my email address. I posted through another guy. I posted one of the most polite letters I ever could have posted on the Flat Earth Research Society.
Why did you have to? No. See, these are the kinds of things that people are saying. You post it through another guy. Why? Their admin, one of the moderators, she's invited you to be part of that. You don't have to post through anybody else. They're more than happy to have you on board. Everybody's trying to give you the benefit of the doubt.
Well, I debate that. You know, he took the first blow in this case. You know, he came out at me, and again, I have nothing bad to say about the guy.
Well, I don't see how, you know, anybody in the flat earth movement could. I find Eric to be really, really bright, very well spoken. He's done a lot of research, and he's probably the guy that's put the flat earth on the map, so to speak.
Okay. I have no problem with that. In fact, his videos were some of the early ones that I watched. Granted, they haven't been out there that long, not as long as Matt from the NASA channels, but absolutely he was an influence in what I did. I have no problem with Eric whatsoever. I can't be any clearer than that.
Well, I think my point that I want to share is, and I can't speak for Eric, but I think what Crow 777, is that who we're talking about here?
Yeah.
He's trying to, and you're agreeing with him, from what I can tell, that the Earth is a hologram.
No, and again,
Can you clear that up?
absolutely. Crow's references. The only reason I reference Crow is because from a moon footage standpoint, you know, when people say, you know, what about the sun and the moon? And I say, look, you want to see some interesting stuff about the moon? Watch this guy's videos. And I, again, I know he's not a flat earther. I tell people that, you know, in interviews, you know, I'm really clear about that. I'm not saying that I agree with Crow's, you know, hologram theory. And I know he doesn't necessarily agree with the flat earth theory. But when it comes to looking at the moon from a different perspective, he is the best footage I've found. And I don't think that's necessarily a conflict with, you know, I don't think that disrupts or hurts the flat earth movement, in my opinion. And Eric disagrees, and I totally understand that, but he can't ask me not to use him.
Well,
It's
I kind of have to disagree. If somebody's that smart, okay, I haven't talked to any intelligent person that when you present them with the evidence for the flood, now some people don't want to look at it. They just don't want to look at it.
Of course.
But once they look at it, they're pretty much convinced. It's pretty hard to disprove it. So
Sure.
why wouldn't somebody like a Crow 777, why wouldn't he look at this and reach the same conclusion that you and I have reached?
Maybe he's just going to take a longer journey. I mean, there's lots of people out there that I've talked to. You know, the one, I mean, there's obviously the big group that rejects it entirely. You know, maybe Crow will come around. But again, you know, like one of Eric's friends asked me, he goes, you know, if you were shown stuff that makes the moon look different, you know, a two-dimensional, you know, transparent moon that you can look through, that sort of thing, you know, would you be willing to go along with that? Absolutely, I would. I have no problem. You know, for me, the sun and the moon are minor players in this. Eric and I use the same map on the ground, the same map that Matt from the NASA channel uses. And that's, you know, part of my message is like, look, let's just get from point A to point B. We can argue about the details when we get there.
I have to disagree. One of the things you said on Shelley's show that gave me that mental indigestion was that you didn't feel you felt like the heat source for the Earth was under the Earth.
I think a lot of the temperature stuff does have to do with what's on the ground, and that's based off of, you know, some of the stuff from Matt from the NASA channel. I
Well,
know he, I
wait a minute. I live in the desert here, Mark. I
yeah.
mean, I walk outside on a summer day in the heat. And the sun is baking us.
Sure.
Then I walk into the shade and there's a 20-degree differential.
Sure.
How it has to be the sun. That's what controls the seasons. It can't
Is
come from underneath.
Well, I disagree. I think the climate system is controlled by several things. You know, use the underwater conveyor from the oceans, the jet stream from up above, the magma systems from down below. They all take part. I'm saying, yes, the sun, of course, generates heat. We all know that. But do I think it is the sole contributor to the temperature system involved in an enclosed system? No, I do not.
Okay, well that's I'm glad you've had a chance to write that down, you know, put that out there today because that's what it sounded like when I heard you say it. So when those things give me mental indigestion.
I hear you.
All right. Okay, so let's go here. There's, you know, people want to say, "Well, what is this guy? He's come out of nowhere." Nowhere with these videos and they're very professionally produced. What's your background? You said you
What?
know how to produce videos of this, you know, quality.
I came from a computer game design background. I have been doing nothing but tech and computer related, and a lot of it has to do with, and I know where you're going with this, because the thought is in the conspiracy world, if it's too polished, then he must have help, and if he has help, then he's a disinfo agent. However, I can assure you that I spent, oh geez, 10 years training people in proprietary software, a lot of which used slides, it used PowerPoint, it used anything that was available. You know, I started in a Macintosh house, which is you know, any Macintosh-based company is going to be more creative. Then I moved over to PC, and I trained classrooms of people around the country in proprietary software. Mostly it was time and attendance, but during that, you know, I learned how to break stuff down into easy to digest chunks, and you know, I got to defend myself here. You know, from a
Yeah, no,
polished state,
I want you to. I mean,
I
that's why I'm asking the hard questions.
no, I got
Needs
you,
to come out.
and I appreciate it. You know, because nobody's asked this yet. You know, from a polished standpoint, it's like, look, you know, I love that people say that it's super polished, but look, I'm using old school stuff here. This is just slideshow and audio tracks laid over the top. I'm using a free program called Windows Live Movie Maker. It is not, you know, hard to use. I mean, yeah, it takes a little finesse here and there, and I do have a bit of a creative streak, but literally I just write the script, I do the audio in small chunks, and that's the thing that screws most people up. And that is, you know, they conspiracy people tend to go on jags, and I broke my stuff up into, I think, 15, 20, maybe 30 second audio segments, and then just laid it onto the slides, you know, made sure I watched it, which a lot of people, they don't do, you know, they put it together and they
I made videos. I know what you're saying.
And that's all I really did. So, and yeah, some of it, you know, I like to, you know, put a little bit more buff on it, you know, to make it more, you know, to make it cooler. But, you know, for the most part, all the videos were just narrative and slides. Yeah, one trailer had some music, another had kind of a little audio overlay. But the rest of it, you know, I don't think I've really even used any video animation, which I was thinking of doing in number 12, but I hadn't made up my mind yet. So there you go. It's not as polished as you might think. It's a lot of sleight of hand there. It looks kind of cool, but Windows Live Movie Maker does most of it for you. It does, you know, the pull-ins and the fade outs and the little sparkly things. That's all boilerplate. It's super easy for me anyway.
So people say, so I haven't seen, have you put ads on your YouTube?
No. As a matter of fact, and again, this is me defending myself because people said, oh, you know, he's got an agenda. He's going for a book deal or a movie deal. It's like, hey, somebody calls me for a movie deal. Fantastic. But I did everything you're not supposed to do when it comes to YouTube stuff when I put it up there. Initially, I didn't allow likes or dislikes. I still don't allow comments. I didn't allow monetization. There was no fund me page, no donation page. In fact, I don't even have a normal web page unless you count my my prepper urban survival thing. You know, and that's really just how to prepare. That's a free thing, you know, in case you want to prepare in case of a disaster. But I don't even really point people to that. So yeah, I did everything wrong and it still gained traction. And that was the part that kind of shocked me because, yeah, I mean, that's the other thing that disinfo people, it's like, well, he came out of nowhere. And I was as surprised as anybody. You know, a narrative and slides and it's getting traction. But everybody that wrote me, that called me.
Okay. Said, okay. All right. No, because this is what people are going to be saying, Mark. You know,
I know.
Do you have... he's not making any money with this.
No.
How are you supporting yourself? Do you have a trust fund? I mean, that's what people think.
I got you. Okay. No, as a matter of fact, what happened was after the stock market crash in 2009, the real estate market was, you know, Boulder actually held up pretty well more than others. And I had some real estate and so I sold it. Made a little money. And as a matter of fact, I'm going to be, you know, going back into programming here actually in a couple more weeks. But I had, you know, quite a bit of time off that, you know, I just, you know, kind of kicked around, took it easy, you know, tried to see what the economic climate was like. But really, in the last 8 weeks, again, it was that weird moment 8 weeks ago where I just, for whatever reason, woke up in the middle of the night and said, you know, I've got a narrative in my head. It, for me, again, nothing against the guys that had the flat earth stuff that was out there, but it came across a little staticky. And I thought, you know what, I could give this thing some structure and, you know, maybe there's something there. And when I did, honestly, I'd never, ever thought that it would get the amount, you know, and I was dumb enough to put my phone number on there, you know, to get the traction it did. And it's been really great. But by the time I was done, by the time I got to Clue 11, you know, I really tried to promote a positive message and say that, look, you know, as far as conspiracies go, not only is it the biggest, but I think it's the only one that could actually, you know, do some good for the world. And that was my motivation.
I agree with that. I want to tell you, I agree. I think this is the mother of all conspiracies. Yeah. I think this has come straight out of Tavistock. It is complete mind control. Very little of what we think of as reality is based in truth.
Yeah.
And I think taking this one down would make everyone wake up and say the government has lied to us our entire lives. Why would we trust them now?
Yep. There is that. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
All right. All right. Well, that's a good backstory so far, but you're not off the hook yet.
Okay.
Okay. People are still going to keep asking here.
Keep shooting. Sure.
I would really like to see you with Eric. I mean, on a show with him and hash this whole thing out.
I would like so too. You know, we've got some points, obviously, that again, in my opinion, I think we agree on a lot of things, you know. I would like to get to a point to where if we agree to disagree, I would hope that at least would not stop us from moving forward. Because
Okay, now this is one of his gripes.
Yeah.
Okay, that I can see in other people. You know, I'll just tell you, other people that aren't, you know, major flat earthers are just coming around to this understanding.
Sure.
And they see it because they know everything's a lie. So it was a little easier for them to look at. Like Wendy that's listening now, she used to think that vaccines were health giving and vaccinated her son and her daughter. And then he had 8 seizures a day. So now she's vaccinetruth.org.
Yikes.
And stuff. So, it takes us a while sometimes to think that the people that we look up to and that are in authority aren't really here for our best interest.
Sure.
But some of them have said, the fact that you people can't see you here today on this interview, but a lot of alternative, you know, media right now has a video component to it. Mm-hmm. They say it rubs them the wrong way that you continually play with that little tennis ball sized globe. I know it's a small thing, but in blink, I mean, that's what people do when they know in their knower that something's not right. They fault you for that.
Yeah, you have an excellent point. And as of the video yesterday, Simon Adkins, he actually told me, he goes, okay, enough with the globe. You know, you probably shouldn't use it anymore. And I agreed. And so the video interview I did yesterday, and I won't be doing it anymore in the future. It was one of those things that was stuck on the side of my refrigerator, and I thought it'd be a good prop because it reinforced in my head, you know, it's like, you know, for me, I didn't want to keep putting it down and picking it up. So I know I kind of fidget with things. And so I was fooling around with it, but for me, it was kind of driving the home. It's like, all right, how do I prove this? And it was a stage prop, and, I know people are tired of seeing it, so you will not see it anymore after this.
All right. Fair enough. Now let's talk about this, you know, because some people say that the flight schedules, the long haul video, I don't know, is it number 7?
Number 7, yeah.
Number 7,
yep.
The long haul, that really doesn't prove anything. It makes you wonder, but there's no real solid proof with that.
You know, it was one of the weaker ones, which is why I waited till number 7 and then did a follow-up on number 9. But for me, it wasn't that weak. It was strong enough for me to do it because as I was trying to, you know, answer the questions in my own head, which was, you know, one, how would I build it? But when I got to the questions of, okay, how would I hide it? That was one of the things that you'd have to do, which was, you know, you'd have to disguise the flights. If you're using the azimuthal map, you'd have to disguise the flights that were on the outer ring, which on a globe is the southern hemisphere. And so, you know, I didn't come up with this on my own. It was initially, you know, a German guy that I saw where he said, look, there's the connections are really weird, but they only make sense on a flat-ish map. And everything that I looked at, it rang true to me because it was what I would do if I was trying to hide it. Again, I was looking at it strictly from a design standpoint. It's like, look, if you're trying to hide flights on the outer ring or the southern hemisphere, the first thing you would do is you would make as many connections as possible.
Okay, let's back up for a minute and tell people that are listening that haven't followed this yet, haven't been and seen your videos.
Oh, okay.
About the short, you not being able to take a shortcut. I would encourage everybody right now as you're looking at us to go and pull up the UN logo. And why don't you tell them about the UN logo first?
Yeah. The UN logo, it's tied to 2 other maps. The Flat Earth Society map, if you look on Wiki, is a top-down view. So if you crushed the globe and looked at it from a top-down view from the North Pole, you'd have a congregation of continents in the center surrounded by a big band of ocean, surrounded by if Antarctica would be stretched in a giant ring on the outside. This map is also used by the USGS, which is the United States Geological Survey. And it is also the flag of the United Nations, which was finished in 1946. And the United Nations flag, which again, very interesting, the map layout is identical to the USGS map, which is identical to the Flat Earth Society map, which is, again, very, very strange because 2 of those maps are considered legit, but the Flat Earth Society map is considered crazy because it's not supposed to be literal. So if you're looking at that map from a top-down point of view, if that map is literal or the United Nations flag is literal, then the two farthest points on that map happen to be South America and Australia. They are, you know, they're very, very far away from each other. If it's a globe, they're not that far away from each other because you just take a quick plane ride across the South Pacific Ocean. It's 7,400 miles. It's not hard. But on a flat map or flat-ish map, that distance, you can't take that South Pacific Ocean route because the ocean becomes stretched, because much, much longer. So the only way that you can make up the time is to cut across the map and take a route that you would never, ever take on a globe. It wouldn't make any sense. So the only way to disguise that is to, one, the first thing is to make a whole bunch of connections. And 95, I know it's hard for people in the Northern Hemisphere to understand because we can get nonstops anywhere. But in the Southern Hemisphere, it is really, really hard to get nonstops, especially between South America and Australia. Most of the flights are connections, and they're weird connections. That's the part that doesn't make...
How weird?
Well, like, for example, if you're going from, say, Buenos Aires to Sydney, Australia, why in the world would you have a connection through Los Angeles or San Francisco? And you're saying, oh, well, they're probably picking up people, they're saving money, and they're doing all this. But when you put it on a flat map, so on a globe, if you're going, you know, going from South America, you're taking this jog way up to Los Angeles or San Francisco, and then you're going way, way back down to Australia. It doesn't make sense. But on a flat map, it's almost a straight line. And the odds of that happening, you know, when you're going from one map to the other, it's way out there. There's no, statistically speaking, it should not be like that. And it happens time and time again. If it's not a straight line, it's just a short dog leg. And it happens in the Southern Hemisphere more often than not. And then, you know, every once in a while, you'll run into like a nonstop. But even the nonstops, and I was glad that this video came out after my clue series. It's called Plane Routes Exposed, and I unfortunately don't know the author. But he was showing that even on some of the nonstops, which is just a handful of nonstops, and people kept emailing me the nonstops saying, hey, there's some nonstops, which is why I did clue number 9. But on the nonstops, the fuel stops. And so these, you'll see that again, not my video, but this other guy's video. And so because people on social media were mentioning it, they're going, hey, this was supposed to be a nonstop flight, but we had an unscheduled fuel stop in, you know, this place or this place. So even
I know airlines do that regularly. I used to live on Maui and there used to be a nonstop somewhere and it would always stop in Hilo, but just because Hilo had a bigger runway and they could fill the fuel. And so we could still take off safely.
There you go.
It wasn't anything, you know, crazy about it. It was just a safety issue.
Oh, sure. But it kind of helps my argument because, you know, people are saying, well, you know, there's obviously, you know, some nonstops, and it's going, really, because the 95% of connections, that doesn't bug you. You know, in the Northern Hemisphere, we can get, you know, it's not even a question of getting a nonstop. It's how cheap can you get it? So anyway, that was one of the big things for me where it was you have to hide the flights in the Southern Hemisphere because the map is wrong, and the distance over the South Pacific Ocean it would be stretched much longer than it appears to be.
And I looked at some flights. I think I used Kayak.
Yep.
And I was checking them from Sydney to somewhere in South America. Let me think where it was. Probably Chile.
Okay.
And let me think. Santiago, Chile. Yeah, that's where I checked. And I was coming up with 12-hour flights, which didn't seem out of the ordinary to me.
And you would be correct. Absolutely. However, what happens there is the route is hidden, which is why, you know, people kept bugging me. You know, they're saying that flight that you were mentioning was one of the handful that was – I can't tell you how many people emailed me those. And I said, okay. So I stared at some of the real time. The one I used was planefinder.net, but there are others. And what was happening was I was trying to find these planes. And once they got over water, open water, say 150, 200 miles, they disappeared from the GPS system. And not only did they disappear from the GPS system, but the individual plane logs, the entry changed from whatever position it was to either approximate or estimated. So those were being blanked out as well. And so what was happening was the plane would leave the airport, get out of over open water, if the computer model was even accurate, which I doubt, and then it would blink out, and would stay blinked out until about an hour before touchdown. And then the plane, out of nowhere, would just blink back in, and then it would land. And, you know, I've had several people say, oh, you know, there's limitations to the GPS system. You know, it's a coverage issue. I'm going, really? Because the Northern Hemisphere, there is no coverage issue, as far as what I can tell. But the Southern Hemisphere, those three oceans, especially the South Pacific and the Indian Ocean and the South Atlantic, to a lesser degree, are more or less blanked out. And, you know, they are going to fix that sooner or later. So I just wanted to bring it to people's attention and say, you know, look, it is what I would do, because you can't show people, if the world is not, again, just depending what shape you think it is, if the world is not a globe, but it is flattish, whatever you want to, you know, if you want to say a wadded up piece of bubble gum or, you know, pancake or, you know, some sort of roulette table, you can't show people how the planes are actually getting from point A to point B. And, you know, for me, it was a strong enough point that I ended up doing two clues on it.
Yeah. Okay. Well, all right. That's good. So, let's talk about, you know, some people disagree with you about the Truman Show kind of thing, that we're here stuck in on this planet.
Yep.
And stuff, but you know, and you really have no way of proving that. Neither do they.
No, I mean, and some people have said, yeah, you know, you're giving me, that's why I did the pick me up video and video 8 with Creative Force, because some people were saying, you know, look, you're giving me small world syndrome. And I don't look at it like that, because they say, you know, yes, I've used the Truman Show because it's such an easy reference to make, or Dark City, which is more sinister. But for me, you know, yeah, if I don't believe, you know, are we trapped? You know, I didn't, you know, people said, you know, you're building a jail, and I completely disagreed. I go, well, if it's a jail, then there's no bars, for one. There, that's being completely hidden. It's a very beautiful jail, if that's the case. And we, you know, for the most part, are acting naturally. The only people that, you know, the only beings that seems to be doing any damage inside an enclosed system would be us. And I think it's more inspirational than anything else. I don't see a sinister aspect. As far as would, you know, are people allowed to come and go? That's a question. You know, can I prove it? No, I can't. But, you know, at the same time, you know, I'm going to go with, you know, the legends and the myths of every culture, every tribe, you know, for the first 4,500 years of our existence, which all talked about the same thing, which was, you know, it was a flattish world that was enclosed in a canopy. That, you know, was,
well, people are going to go off on that flattish thing. If you're going to say this, you know, concave at the pole, a convex at the pole, people are going to go crazy on that, you know?
Yeah, I know. I know.
So what do you say to that?
Again, until my problem is, unfortunately, until, I mean, I agree with the ground map for the most part. I think the azimuthal equidistant, I don't think it's coincidence, you know, that the UN flag uses it and the USGS. But as far as the overall lumps and shapes, I mean, and again, some people said, you know, you really shouldn't refer to the Orlando Ferguson map, you know, the flattened stationary earth that he did in 1830. But it's a pretty good map. I like it. You know, it's not perfect. It's, you know, until I come up with a computer model that's better, I kind of like the shape, because it kind of fits into, you know, that hump, that roulette table hump in the North Pole thing. It explains a couple things. One, it explains some curvature, and two, it kind of dovetails into the hollow earth theory, which, you know, I bought into for a number of years and still don't discount it, but I think it dovetails.
I haven't looked at hollow earth enough to be able to make a, you know, a good defense or.
It's kind of a light read. There's not a lot out there on it.
Yeah. It's very, very, very small. And it's interesting that Bird was involved in both of these.
Exactly. Yeah.
So, but here's the thing. This concave thing, I don't see it. All the science that they've done to prove, the world is round, this curvature of the earth thing,
sure,
all come up negative. They've all been 6 miles, 30 miles, all come up negative for curvature.
Are you talking about the, are we talking about the pure concave theory, or are we just talking about any lumps whatsoever?
Well, I know we know that there are mountains in different, you know, geologic features on the earth.
Oh, yeah.
But the fact that the North Pole, you're saying, it looks like a roulette table.
It's just the one I like. I mean, do I and I know, again, the pure flat earthers say it's as, you know, as flat, you know, with the exceptions of what you just said, the mountains and everything, you know, it's as flat as a coin. And for me, it's like, I mean, again, I could go with that as well. The big reason why I kind of went with the hump and the Orlando Ferguson thing was it, the model and the animation seemed to be a little easier when it came to sunrise and sunset and the moonrise and sunset. It seemed a little easier to fit into, but again, I'm not going to discount the, you know, the pancake flat thing, because I've seen other people with, you know, doing light tests, you know, at very recently this year, showing that it can also be done, you know, with a pure flat model. So no, I'm not discounting it.
Yeah, I see, that's that kind of being married to that concept.
Yeah,
you know, and putting that out is what people start saying. COINTELPRO. That's what they say.
I hear you. And
ones that sets people off.
I hear you. And I again, if I am not, I am not married to that in any sense of the word. It's just when I, you know, again, when I was building it, and you know, my physics stuff isn't as strong as it probably should be. It for me, it made a little more sense. However, what you just said there, look, if it'll keep me out of the counter Intel world, I'm more than happy to back off on that. Absolutely. You know, if people say, look, if that's the only sticking point to keep people from saying horrible things, then by all means.
To let go of that. Otherwise, you're going to have, where are the oceans? The oceans are all running downhill at that point.
No.
You know, how's the water stick up there? Then you got to get back to the gravity nonsense.
And yeah, I know. I know. And the gravity argument, unfortunately, is a tough one, because, you know, and then, but again, for me, it's not the, you know, it's a little more than splitting hairs, but it's still a detail that I think should be, you know, there should be a little flexibility there, you know, from.
That's what people say, you know, I agree that people think that this, you know, it has to be one or the other. And I don't think you can support something that's going to say, oh, there's gravity, when we don't see any gravity. I mean, if there was really gravity and it worked like this, and the moon was actually the sphere that they say it is, I mean, then the earth being that much bigger that as they say it is, it should be sucking the moon right into us, because it's repelling it. I mean, it's nonsense.
I get you. I totally get you. But at that point, then you're talking about, you know, then you're comparing technologies, because it's like, okay, what exactly would be holding the moon up, you know, or the sun for that matter, and where, you know, where does the sun draw its power source? Again, for me, it's really, remember, I haven't been doing this that long, so for me, it's a work in process, but my first priority was to get people out of the globe model entirely. That was my number one thing. It's like, look, whatever you think they're passing off as a globe isn't. Now, whatever the exact shape may be, you know, it's going to be in question until, you know, some independent source comes out there and tries to determine it. But I'm doing my best, trying not to butt heads as much as possible. You know, a lot of this is just my opinion, and again, I apologize for anyone out there that I might be rubbing the wrong way.
Well, you know, I mean, I found Eric to have an open door. He'd be here with us tonight, but it's 5 a.m. in Thailand.
All right.
You know, and so, but I found him just as approachable as you are. He doesn't have a phone number. I'm not going to call Thailand, but he's available on the boards. He's always responded to me on the boards. He's responded to me on Facebook.
I will try to, for you. For you, I will do this. I will try to contact him directly. I do not want to get into some sort of contest on the boards itself, especially on his channel, or, you know. And
you know what? I know people there would be polite. People are still defending you over there. Everybody wants to give you the benefit of the doubt, Mark.
Well, that's a nice thing to say, but I've gotten some emails from his camp, which are less than coherent.
Okay, that's his camp. That's not him.
All right.
Okay. This has got to be man to man.
I will try. I will do what I can. I will reach out to him. As a matter of fact, once I'm done with you, I will reach out to him and see if we can come to any sort of meeting. But he cannot, unfortunately, he cannot ask me to do things just because he says so. You know,
I don't think he wants you to do that. I mean, have you read his book?
No. No, I haven't actually.
I mean, that's kind of, that now that puts a red flag in my mind. Here's a guy that's written a book about the flat Earth, And it's pretty well known. And it's that all the research, he went through all the research from the people that wrote books in the 1800s and all the experiments they did. And you say you've been looking at this for a number of years now and you haven't read this book. I mean,
No, not a number of years, nine months. And no, I didn't even know his book existed until I was actually putting out the videos. And then Matt from the NASA channel actually called me and told me, hey, guys, you know, he wrote a book. Honestly, I was like, I think at like video three or five by the time I even knew he had a book.
So what's your relationship like with Matt Boylan?
It's off and on. Matt's a good guy, but if the flat Earth movement was a group of pirates, he would be Captain Jack Sparrow, because you don't know exactly which way he's going to go. And I like his style, I like his energy, I like his passion, and I still refer to that initial video that his girlfriend did on him, you know, years ago, as probably one of the most brilliant things I've ever, you know, because he was so clear and so concise.
Okay, the one where he's talking about when he was at the party in the hamster.
Yeah. It's a fantastic video, and I recommend it to anybody who's listening. It's like, look, it's because that's flat Earth.
Yeah, that's the one I send out.
Yeah, but he tended to go down the conspiracy rabbit hole a little bit further, and you know, he asked me to do some things. I won't say them on air. I'll say them off air with you if you want. That I think were a little out of bounds, and so he
ties it all together. I mean,
he does, but you know, we had some disagreements. It's like, you know, it's like, well, look, I, you know, on stuff that was not flat Earth, and I just couldn't agree with him on that, and so, you know.
Yeah, I haven't heard him say anything about, you know, like a geoengineering, or, you know, how they're engineering wars and things. I haven't heard him say anything I disagree with.
Do you want me to talk about it?
Sure, go ahead.
Okay. You know, he asked me, you know, in an email, he basically wanted me to put in, you know, an anti-Jesuit message into my interviews and possible future clues. And it's like, I thought I was very clear in my videos. It's like, look, religion, I try to be as objective, as neutral as possible. I'm a very spiritual person, but there was no way I was going to attack a specific group. And then he was a man of his word. I'll say that, because that last 2.5 hour thing he did, you know, that's exactly what he did. You know, he went after him. And
well, you know, you have to say there's got to be something about, you know, the Vatican and the Rothschilds in all of this.
Oh, no doubt. Hey, look, you know, there's some wonderful conspiracies out there regarding them. I'm not gonna defend those groups. However, I think, you know, it would be I would lose more. I didn't want to go off on too many tangents. If I was going to do that, I might as well do the tangent where people were giving me a whole bunch of crap saying that the nukes weren't, you know, real. And it's like, look, I know that conspiracy too, but you can't throw everything into one pot. You know, you got to start slow, because otherwise you're going to lose people. Look, I mean, flat Earth is
a, hey, is a, if flat Earth doesn't lose them right there, you might as well throw in the kitchen sink.
Yeah, I know, but I tried to stay on focus, and I, you know, again, I like Matt. I'm not going to say anything bad about Matt. He is literally the guy. He was on an island when nobody else was doing this. I mean, I cannot imagine being him, you know, being 24, 25, and having this dropped in his lap, because the fact that he's not in a mental institution is amazing. Because that would I don't know if I could have coped if someone said, oh yeah, by the way, I know you're not into conspiracies, but the world isn't round, and you're hearing this from a NASA guy. That rattles your soul. And so, you know, the fact that he's still upright and not drooling, I'm proud of him. He's a good guy.
Yeah, I think the fact that he's taken to comedy and things like that to protect himself. I mean, because this is the mother of all. So do you fear for your safety telling these things?
And people have asked me that too. And I think I would if I ever got married or had kids. In fact, I probably wouldn't have done the clues had I, you know, because there's responsibilities to be had, and you don't want to put family at risk. But for me, you know, for whatever reason, I wanted to do this, and I was just going to put myself out there, and I joked with people all the time. It's like, you know, the joke was, okay, you know, if I do, you know, get suits and sunglasses show up at my door, who exactly would they be? That was the thing that I was curious about. So who has jurisdiction in this case? You know, is it even America? You know, are we talking NSA? Is it a group that's higher than the NSA? Is it an alphabet group that no one's even heard of? Would they even speak English as their first language?
Since NASA speaks English, I think you can pretty much figure it.
And after one of my, it's funny, after one of the interviews I did where we actually had callers, NASA actually called in like 30 minutes after I went off air. And from Johnson Space Center, and was saying, you know, the guys were on there saying, oh yeah, you know, absolutely, the world is round. And I was more curious, it's like why they were listening to the show in the first place. But I am a little nervous here and there, but at the same time, it just seems, you know, it's like, look, I'm out there at this point. It's either going to happen or it's not going to happen, and let's hope it doesn't. I don't want to be made an example of, but there's got to be a reason why I'm doing it. If you believe in, you know, Providence.
Well, do you believe in Providence? So who built this thing?
That's the big question, isn't it? For me, I try to take the positive aspect, which is someone, you know, let's put it this way. I do believe in a divine power, absolutely. Now, this thing seems to be built with such a huge level of efficiency, maybe omnipotence isn't the word I would use. Is it an older version of us? Yeah, maybe. You know, is it a higher civilization that's looking for novelty, looking to, you know, to see if a better person can be built? Yeah, maybe. You know, or I'll take even one more. You know, did we volunteer to be here? That's a very real possibility, because this world seems to be nothing but pure conflict when it comes to us. It seems inescapable, almost to a design standpoint, if that's possible. Can you build a world where no one can escape conflict as far as human beings are concerned? So they're all possibilities. I try not to necessarily pick one but I try to stay positive. How's that? I don't want to go down the sinister, you know, the Matrix, you know, that we're here as a fuel source or something, you know, really, really dark.
There are some interesting theories around like that, like Michael Tellinger's. I don't know if you're familiar with his work and how all the ancient sites, when they're viewed from an, you know, aerial view of them, they look like computer chips. And the, you know, the
especially the Mexican
Africa. Yeah, and they're all over, even the, you know, the Acropolis and all that. I mean, they were actually, there was something about sound that was being generated that they get power from, and all the, you know, stadiums and things like that. That's kind of interesting. We know very little, because all the ancient libraries have pretty much been destroyed and whatnot. That might have given us some clues, as we'd say.
Yeah, and you know, it's also it became pretty evident to me that, again, we're not the first people to rent this apartment by any stretch. There's huge gaps in our history with civilizations. You know, how many cities do you have to look at that are hidden underwater to know that, you know, we're not the first people here? So
no, absolutely not. And I think that brings up an interesting point. So why do they keep reseeding this place? You know, even if you read the Bible, most people that I know will look Genesis 1:1 to Genesis 1:2. There's something cataclysmic that happened. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, you know, and the words without form and void. Well, who creates something without form and void? And he tells us to go replenish the earth. Well, you can't replenish something that hasn't been plenished in the first place.
Excellent. Yeah. 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 Very true. And yeah, there's massive time gaps, even, yeah, in the, especially in the Old Testament, where, yeah, lots of things have gone by. I mean, the ruins, you know, how many old ruins, you know, that we can't date, and, you know, can the carbon dating system even be trusted at all?
We haven't been able to recreate the pyramids yet.
Yeah. 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 The pyramids are the most fascinating thing out there. One, that they've survived as long as they have. I know they're in a geologic place where, you know, it minimizes, you know, erosion and earthquakes and stuff. But yeah, they're a fascinating. How old are they? Are they 10,000 years old? Are they 50,000 years old? Nobody knows.
Yeah, nobody knows. But the last time there was rain on the Giza plain, that would be, you know, was a long time ago, like 20,000 years probably.
Yeah.
If we, and who knows? How do we know?
Yeah. Yeah,
I mean, there's no way of knowing.
Our records only go back 5,000 years, and after that, they become really, really scattered. And after that, yeah, it's a free-for-all. You don't know.
So, you know, look at the North Carolina bays created by cataclysm. Those were created by whatever you want to say, they're rocks or asteroids or whatever. Something came out of the sky. And to go back to the sky thing, I follow the guys at Electric Universe, like Wal Thornhill and David Talbot, and they look at all the mythology. Are you familiar with their work, Symbols of an Alien Sky?
Not so much.
I'd look into them. Symbols of an Alien Sky, worth watching.
Okay.
Electric Universe, that would, some people have said that the sun is really just a capacitor.
Oh, like Eric Dollard.
Yeah, Eric Dollard may be one of the people that said that. So
that little interview, and I know some people think it's ridiculous, but where he was sitting in the car and he, you know, he was talking about what the sun was and wasn't. That gave me tingles because I was going, wow. He put into perspective that I hadn't even thought of. It was brilliant.
Well, I'll have to watch that one.
Oh, you probably have. But it's a film student shooting him. He's literally sitting in the front seat of a car and it's not very long, maybe 5 minutes. And he's talking about the sun as a capacitor.
Oh, that's where I came up with it. It's not very long. I'm sure I've seen it then.
Yeah. Where he says, look, it's not generating. He goes, there's no fusion up there. He goes, I don't know what the sun is. Nobody knows what the sun is. He goes, but it's not what you think it is. And it's, you know.
It's not what they're telling us it is.
No,
and it can't be as far away as they're saying it is.
No.
That much is clear, because we wouldn't have the God rays through the clouds at angles. It would all be coming straight down.
Which another guy who I looked at, even though it's a little tough to get your head around my perspective, that guy's name is Rory Cooper out of South Africa.
Yeah, he does very good work, my perspective, because he does all those program type videos.
Yeah. He's got some really great stuff. Again, you got to be able to think in a three-dimensional kind of pan around way, but some of it's really, really good. And he questions, you know, he does a comparison. It's great. It's like, here's what happens with light on a flat surface. Here's what happens, you know, on a globe, you know, and if the sun is this distance versus the sun. Oh yeah. It's great, great stuff.
I like his work. And then, but you know, I hear some music. Stick with us. We'll be back and we'll keep grilling. Mark Sargent has been such a good sport about it. Stay with us, everybody.
Let the magic rise.
The opinions expressed on this radio station, its programs, and its website by the hosts, guests, and call-in listeners or chatters are solely the opinions of the original source who expressed them. They do not necessarily represent the opinions of Revolution Radio and FreedomSlips.com, its staff, or affiliates.
You're listening to Revolution Radio, FreedomSlips.com, 100% listeners.
Welcome back to Sacred Cow Barbecue, everyone. We've got we've got ribs, we've got prime rib, we've got hamburgers, we've got steaks. I mean, we are slaying them all here today. And my guest, Mark Sargent, is being very patient with my questions about him being COINTELPRO about the flat Earth. And you know, because I came to radio because of the Bundy Ranch, and I've never seen a thing so trolled up and so COINTELPRO going on in my life. I saw it up close and personal. So the fact that I have questions about people shouldn't surprise anyone. Mark, welcome back.
Thanks. Glad to be back.
Okay, Wendy, you're still here, right?
Yes, I am.
Okay, Wendy had to call in. She couldn't figure out how to get on Freedom Slips. That's too bad, but good. Listen, before we go to your question, Wendy, I want to talk about this, about the Flat Earth Society. You say you post over there and you mention them, but when I go over there, Mark, that thing is so trolled up, just clowns, and it's horrendous. Why would you waste your time over there?
No, I've never posted a thing on the Flat Earth Society. I went there. I joined, and that was part of the journey here, was I joined last year, and it took, five, 6 months to get my actual membership card, because I thought it would initially be fun. When I was trying to debunk this, I thought, well, you know, I'm going to actually be a card carrying, and I still do. I've got a laminated card sitting in the other room. But what was interesting was when I got there, you know, and I was looking through the forums, I thought it might be kind of a friendly, fun place, but there were, dedicated trolls that were just really going after new members. And it was this weird little routine where a new member would show up and was like, hey, it's my first time here, what's going on? And these trolls would be like, no, it's not a serious thing. The Flat Earth Society isn't serious in any form. It's just a joke, nothing to see here, move along. You know, like shutting them down at the door. And I was going, why would you do that? You know, I didn't know, I'm a little naive when it comes to some troll stuff. And so I was going, this is a very, very small group. You know, the worldwide members that are in the membership roster is less than 600, even as of right now. So, and if you're into trolling, I mean, good Lord, you can go to YouTube all day long and troll 24/7 and just torture people. So why would you go fishing in waters that were just barren by comparison? And so, yeah, I mentioned that in my first video. I said, look, I'm a member, but I'm not doing anything there because it doesn't seem, because, all you need is a couple trolls and you scare everybody away. So there's no point in doing anything there at the moment.
Okay, because I remember I heard you that you posted there and you're fighting trolls there all the time and stuff like
that. No. Never actually posted there. I joined, but I couldn't post because there's people that have mirrored my videos there, which is cool. But again, the trolls, attack them almost immediately. And no, let's put it this way: the trolls were so intimidating on that side that I immediately said, no, I can't post in there. It's too toxic, which is again strange for such a small group.
Yeah, and so that's Eric Dubé's point that the Flat Earth Society is actually a NASA controlled, disinfo.
Yeah, and yeah, he started his the Flat Earth Research Society. I would
actually
have gone with
it's International Flat Earth Research Society.
Yeah,
IFERS.
Yeah, I probably would have gone with a different name just because it's close enough that it falls into that, the Monty Python skit, the Judean People's Front versus the People's Front of Judea. Yeah. And so I was like going,
I think he was naming it after some, I think he was reviving a real flat earther's work.
Ah, got it.
That's why he named it. It was in homage to someone that had started that before. So it was just reviving.
Ah, okay.
So,
okay. But so now there's two of them and,
And I have to say, if anyone's interested, I would go there. IFERS, is it .com or .org? Let me look. Hold on. I don't know that offhand. Hold on. I would say that's got to be, I don't even know. Let me look. Hold on. Let me go back. Try them both and see what happens. And because I find that to be a very articulate, people agree to disagree over there, and it's well moderated. I mean, they don't put up with a lot of nonsense, and so I think that's the real deal there. So I guess it's not. Okay, it's got to be .net. Well, I know, and that's like International Academy of Oral Medicine and Toxicology. Obviously, a mercury poison dentist named that as well.
Maybe Eric's doing something on maintenance.
Okay, maybe something's going on. Okay, well, the Flat Earth Society. I'm telling you, this is kind of crazy. All right, so we'll keep looking. I'll put it
either way. It's the International Flat Earth.
When I post this on my archive, I'll post the real link to it. So apologies to Eric, and we'll make that work. So, Wendy, you had a question.
Yes, my son was asking me. If we don't have any real pictures of the round Earth, do we have any pictures of the flat Earth?
No.
That they're just
depressing. You couldn't. You could never release that, and that's the whole point of this: is that if you actually found out that it's the crux of everything, which is if you knew the Earth wasn't round, and then you finally sent up rockets high enough, or any object high enough to take pictures, and you found out it wasn't round, would you, regardless of what shape it was, would you tell anybody? And the answer for me was a resounding no, because men in power, and I'm really talking about men here, not women, there would be such a fundamental shift in spirituality and religion that it would take them decades to try to backpedal from it. What I mean is, if it was an enclosed system, you're basically giving all the religions of the world their holy grail all at once, because all of them would say, would immediately say there's a creator behind it, there's intelligent design behind it, therefore science has lied to us and the government has lied to us. And
Well, don't you see intelligent design here?
You mean from what I've been seeing?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, absolutely I have.
Well, see, I think okay, 501c3 churches are in on the fix. So I don't see anybody running to their church saying, oh, we knew all along. No, because I've seen pastors stand up there and say that the Bible said that the earth was a globe a long time ago, and they use that circle, you know, scripture. And so I don't see that happening.
If you're a government or a science-based, and you might be right, that at the highest levels, they may be in on it, absolutely. But from a science government standpoint, are you going to take the chance? And I've learned, you know, more often than not that the authority in question does not take chances if they can avoid it. Do you take the chance and let something like this happen to the world?
The internet is kind of, you've gotten a lot of traction. I was shocked. Wendy, were you shocked when you went to YouTube and saw how many flat earth videos there were?
I was blown away.
Yeah.
I was weeks. It questioned our friendship about her telling me about this. Because I couldn't stop. I couldn't stop watching it. It was so compelling.
Most of them have been this year. And there's people coming out now every day. Not me. I mean, I've made, 10 or 11. But it's getting way more traction. I shouldn't use the word universally, but it is in a broad spectrum for no apparent reason. I mean, again, you would ask me this last year, I would have laughed you out of the room.
But Eric's been at this for a good 6 years at least, right? 6 or 8 years.
Yeah, but even his videos, unless he changed the channel, haven't been up that long, maybe 4 or 5 months. I mean, his book was out, but the videos haven't been up there that long.
I think he's done a lot of, you know, radio interviews and things. And the radio hosts that I hear him on with, he convinces them. An hour into it, they're convinced. There's no question. So then they get on the team, and there's several people that have joined the team. But it seems to me that most of the people that I hear talking about the flat earth probably are because of Eric Dubay.
Yes.
You know, so how many converts do you feel like you've had, Mark? How many people listen to you and go, oh, yeah, he's right?
In interviews or emails?
Both.
A lot more than I thought, that's for sure. With the interviewees, it's kind of a mixed bag. I mean, there's been a couple, but most of them have been pretty much on board from what I've run into. And the emails just keep coming. You know, people are saying, you know, the biggest comment is that you gave me digestible pieces that finally I could get my head around it. You know, a lot of these people, you know, weren't into the math or they weren't into the physics. And they said, you know, because I used broad strokes, I'll be the first one to admit that. And they said, you know, that I asked questions that they really hadn't heard of. So it's like, all right, cool, fantastic. But people are, again, the fact that we're talking about this right now is just blows me away, because this is a topic that was so taboo even a year ago. And now we've seemed to have moved past the part of, okay, it's not taboo anymore. Let's talk about how it's actually possible. It's fantastic in my opinion.
Wendy, you had another question, I think, during the break. Do you remember what it was?
Well, I was just going to say, I think the most compelling part is the flight paths. That, to me, was that sealed the deal right there.
Because you were a res agent.
Yeah, I used to work for the airlines. And, when you see from Australia to Dubai, Dubai to Africa, really?
Yeah.
You know, and it's when you put the flat earth together, I just wish there was a picture of the flat earth. You know, that we could say...
If there was, it would be the most valuable picture of all time, if you had one.
There must be millions of them, because they're taking them up there, and then they have to, you know, Photoshop them into a circle.
Well, you know, a lot of those shots you can do with just spy planes at 20, 30 miles, you know, because people are saying, well, you know, how does Google Earth work? And, you know, you don't have to go very high to create a composite image. And in fact, somebody suggested to me, you know, if you wanted to, you could do it like Google with the cars. You could just put, you know, a camera system on the bottom of commercial planes, and you'd have the whole world in less than a month. You know, you wouldn't even need the military to do it. But yeah, I know what you want. I mean, look, everybody would love a picture of what the Earth really looks like. But it is the most guarded secret, in my opinion, ever. And they've got that under tight lock and key at the moment.
Hey, one of the folks that produce around here said somebody in the chat room said it's ifers.boards.net. IFERS.boards.net. Well, that's what I'd say. I thought there was a lead into that, but ifers.boards.net. So I would run over there and do some reading.
Okay.
If I was anybody that's listening to this, that's a place that I found that's safe to go. People are polite. They disagree. Now, Mark, let's go back to this church thing. I look at the government as being Frankenstein and the church as the bride of Frankenstein.
Nice analogy.
It's not mine. It was an artist named Paul Bunch made an illustration like that, and it stuck with me.
Okay.
So I've always seen that the priestcraft has always been here to control the people. Mm-hmm. So I wonder just how many, you know, so you've got people now, and I was a Bible thumper. I was a missionary in Honduras. I could defend the Bible all day long. Well, I can't do that anymore. But this happens to be one of the topics in the Bible that the Bible is right about.
Yeah.
So people say, well, if it's right about this, it's right about everything. But they fail to acknowledge the fact that most of the New Testament is a forgeries.
Yeah.
You know, so it's hard. So, you know, I you can't argue with zealots that they're going to get this. But I don't see the part that you see, that you think that the church is just going to take over after we denounce the scientists and the government, and the church is going to take over and have this totalitarian church thing. We all got to believe by then. I don't see that happening.
And you may be right. It may not happen. Yeah. But if I'm talking, you know, strictly from a secular point of view, you know, if I was on the other side of that, again, there is a marriage there between, you know, the church and government at high levels and absolutely, you know, power over the people. But to reorganize stuff, I think would be at the very least. You might be right. The church may not go on a rampage and condemn science and start, you know, just destroying things and turn into a weird futuristic society, you know, that's straight out of, you know, Priest or 1984 or something like that. But at the same time, just the restructuring of everything, it would be a lot of work.
Yeah.
From a practical standpoint.
I like that. We've got a question from the chat room that I want to answer right away, and then we can get back to this. It says, Mark, if the world is flat, why don't we fall off the edge? Well, because we can't get to the edge. That's the problem.
And that is one of the oldest arguments there is. And in fact, there's wonderful pictures out there of, you know, the water falling off the edge and the boats falling off the edge. But in this sort of model, when you get out to Antarctica, which is the most unique continent of anything out there, it slopes up 2 miles minimum and then plateaus out 2 miles high, and that's, you know, and then gets even higher from there. So
it says who? And that was Bird?
Yeah. I think that's, I mean, it should be pretty well confirmed, but, you know, how high, at least the minimum height. But yeah, you got a good point there. Does it plateau and keep plateauing? I know that minimum height, again, depending on who you talk to, is 10,000 feet, and then it goes up from there. But if that was the case, then you wouldn't have to worry about water or anything falling up the edge, if you could even get to the edge. The edge is protected, and as far as climate goes, is extremely hostile when you get out there. So no, nobody's falling off the edge because you can't get there, your point.
Okay. And then it says something about, why did they lie to us about not being able to sail the seas? I don't know what that question means, but let's talk about Columbus.
Okay.
Because Columbus, everyone thinks that, oh, his crew tried to mutiny because they thought the earth was flat and they were going to sail off the edge. But it's actually opposite that. Do you agree?
I did not know that story.
Okay. Well, it's actually, I hear it's opposite because they thought they'd been bought into the globe model by then.
Oh.
And they thought they were going to fall off the side because you'd have what I mean, if you stand on a board flat or you stand on a ball, what do you have a bigger chance of falling off of? You have a chance of falling off the ball. The ball's unstable. It's, you know, so I mean,
that's good. That's good. I had not heard that.
So that's why Columbus knew that the earth was flat and he was trying to, you know, say, no, don't worry, guys. We're not going to sail off the, you know, we're not going to fall off the globe here. There is no globe. It's flat. So that's what I've heard about that. So, but then he asked kind of an interesting question. Why does every other planetary object look like a globe? Well, that's because we're not really seeing anything. They're all artist renditions. And so you've got to see Matt Boylan's work if you want to see how they create those. We don't have any pictures of Mars, of Saturn, of Jupiter, of any of this nonsense, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Plus, to your point there, you know, why would everything be a globe? Everything became globes at the same time. That's what that's the cool part about the globe model is, because once you become the globe, that means everything else that's circular in the sky becomes a globe automatically by default. So, you know, before that, it's literally just pretty pictures in the sky. And as soon as you become a globe, everything else becomes a globe. And then, you know, everything clicks in at once. And it's, you know, it's an illusion all at the same time.
So we think this this canopy of stars that we see, mm-hmm. and these brightest stars that we call planets are just that. They're just bigger stars. And we really don't know what the stars are.
Yeah, bigger images, you know, slightly better rendered images, you know, depending on how you want to look at it.
And so does anybody have a big enough telescope to look at this kind of stuff? No. Only NASA says they do, and we can prove that the Hubble images are just beautiful. I've always loved them. I wanted to kind of have a group of them over my fireplace. They're such pretty art, and turns out that's exactly what they are.
Yeah, and the Vatican has control over a few observatories as well.
Yeah, do you ever go to a planetarium? How come they're always domed?
There you go. Yeah, the planetarium. Oh heck, I'll do one better. The Disneyland, Pirates of the Caribbean. You know, you know that the stars and everything above, you know, it's fake. But considering that thing, that ride was built 60 years ago, it's beautiful. You know, and that stuff we can do right now on a stage. You know, imagine what you could do with unlimited resources and technology.
Yeah. So what is NASA doing with the money?
They're burning it mostly. Unfortunately, it started out as such a simple deception. And as we've gone along the last, you know, 50, 60 years, it has become a spider web of money that has just been thrown down the drain.
Well, I think they've got to be taking the money and doing something with it, don't you?
Oh, yeah.
It's got to go into black ops or something.
You're absolutely right. Yeah, you're not going to blow all of it. You know, you're gonna mark up the budget projections, no question. But yeah, so some of the money they're putting into rockets, and those rockets are being ditched in the ocean. They're being crashed in other places. You know, they're being landed.
That's one of Mark's best videos, is Flat Earth Comedy Theater, showing all the rockets blowing up, and Eric. That's why I'm sorry, Mark.
Oh, no worries.
that's one of Eric's better videos. I think that's pretty entertaining. Yeah. So let's talk about this for another minute. About we can't really prove the firmament. Nobody's ever crashed into it that we know of.
Nope.
So why would they? Why do you think they were setting off all those high altitude nuclear blasts? I live in Nevada. We know nuclear blasts.
Yeah. Well, if it was me, and again, I was trying to put myself in their shoes. The first thing you'd want to, again, this is a male reaction, 100%, is if you found out there was some sort of barrier, regardless of the substance and how permeable you thought it would be, the first thing you would do is like, okay, can we get under it? Can we get through it? And once you figure out, you know, why we can get through it should be the first reaction, instead of, you know, trying to figure out what the dimensions are. But starting in 1958, the United States and Russia started up their nuke program. They just basically, you know, the rockets were very, very young, barely even a year old. They put atomic weapons on the top of them, and they start firing, you know, up pretty much straight up aerial tests, and they do it for 4 years. And after the first two big shots, which were, you know, 3.88 megaton a pop, they seemed to ramp it down, like they were just probing. Which is what I would do. You know, the easiest way to map it out would be to paint the sky. Therefore, you know, you work in the geometry, you work out the arc, you know, see how high it is, you know, just different aspects of it, because you have to figure out at that point how high, if you know in advance you're going to have to fake the space program, you need to know how high the rockets can go, mm-hmm. before having to roll over and do, you know, their arc.
Change the trajectory, right?
Change the trajectory. And by the way, love the fact that one of the American nuke packages was called Operation Fishbowl. Love the fact that they use that name. You know, where they came up with that, anybody's guess. Russia didn't name their stuff, you know, like we did. But yeah, and so then they both stopped firing those shots at the exact same day in 1962, at the end of 1962. And then they both, you know, fired up their space program, you know, which was, as we know now, is the space race.
We know, I'm fully convinced that NASA was a complete fraud.
Oh, yeah.
Kubrick did the whole thing. Was Sputnik?
probably. It's hard to say because from the Russian side, we don't have nearly as much public disclosure from the Russian side. I know it's like, oh, you know, America was telling us all sorts of things. Well, maybe not. But Russia, you know, I'll go the other side on that one. It's like, why did Russia give up their space program? Because they realized the Americans were way better at faking it than they were.
Yeah.
And so it's like, you know, the argument's like, you know, why wasn't there this big competition, you know? Everybody knows full well there should be moon bases by now by both Russians and the Americans.
So if you listen to ex-NASA people like Hoagland, Richard Hoagland, there are. But now I see Hoagland as being a complete shill as well.
Yeah. And I didn't touch on this in any of my stuff. But yeah, the hidden space program, which in my opinion is a great little angle, which is – you know, because it reinforces the real space program. It's like, all right, fine, you know, Apollo was faked, but we have this hidden space program that nobody knows about. And it's like, really? Because at that point, then you're legitimate, you know, it's like, well, okay, that's the real program. And everybody knows we're actually out in space, but that one's probably fake too. And
okay, we've got a lot of ground to cover. And I thought we might run out of stuff to talk about in 2 hours. Silly me. Okay. But so I want to cover this. How did NASA recruit the pilots to be the original astronauts, emphasis on knots. My feeling is that they said to them, this is for national security, because they would believe in the Russian thing. You've got to come in. And they got people to buy into it. So yeah. I can understand the original guys, but mm-hmm. How are they doing that now?
Now they're just Air Force employees. Now, in fact, I felt horrible for the original astronauts, which was, I think they really thought they were going to be heroes and you know, were literally the right stuff, you know, not to rip off the movie too much. But now, because they had to disclose to them. But now these guys that are up there, the people that are they're doing the stuff, and we can get into the ISS thing later if you want.
Yeah.
But for them, they're not even qualified enough to get disclosure. So they sign the waivers and, you know, they're on the payroll from day one because NASA learns, you know, any agency will learn mistakes as time goes on. And so now it's like, okay, here's what you're going to do. You're going to go up in the Vomit Comet, you know, the 727, I think it is, and you're going to simulate this and this and this. And you do not have any clearance to even ask why. You're just going to do it. You're going to do what we tell you. You're going to get paid well for it. And that's it. Which is why I think they're completely in the clear conscience wise. Now, you know, they may know, you know, or they may ask questions. You know, it's like, why are we faking this anyway?
Well, they've been astronauts, you know, how did it feel to be the first man on the moon? And he burst into tears and left the testimonial dinner.
Poor Neil.
That could just be an urban legend, but, you know.
Well, look at the Apollo 11, the first debriefing one, where they're in front of that international press club. And Neil looks like, honestly, somebody shot his dog.
Yeah.
And he was a wreck, and he stayed a wreck for years. Some of the astronauts coped better than others. But, you know, they were the ones, it's, you know, they had to break it down and NASA made, you know, learned from that. And they said, okay, everybody else at this point is on a need to know basis and nobody needs to know ever, you know?
Yeah. Well, it's pretty interesting that NASA can keep, I'm sure the rank and file people probably think that, you know, it's on the level because I've met people from there.
Sure.
That work for NASA, but the higher ups, what is it? Did we just hire sociopaths that love to fool people, love to lie?
Well, I mean, how many people do you have to keep in the loop? I've mentioned him a couple times. The guy that used to be my neighbor, Wayne Ottinger, who was the senior garage mechanic, you know, in perspective, you know, he knew all the astronauts, built most of the equipment, built the first early lander, and there was absolutely no doubt in my mind he was out of the loop. He was way too proud of NASA. His walls were just bristling with plaques and all this stuff. And I, you know, and people say, why didn't you ask him about it? It's like, are you kidding? He's absolutely in the clear.
These people believe it. It's like the biggest paternal organization. It's,
yeah,
you know,
yeah. But at
their
the
mom, dad combined.
Yeah, at the highest levels, yeah, you have to let people know. But how many do you have to really let know? You know, people that control, you know, that are department heads, maybe over the original telemetry, but you don't have to let. Who knows how many?
Well, you know, it's interesting because the folks that used to be the flat Earth people over in somewhere in the high desert in California near Edwards Air Force Base, They knew people from Edwards Air Force Base when they were building the space shuttles and stuff. And they said they were gluing stuff on with epoxy. They couldn't even move it. It was so flimsy. So it would break off and they glue it back on. I mean, it's just nonsense. And did you see the video? I don't know who put this out, but it shows one of the original reporters, like in the 60s, showing how there was an escape hatch. You know, when they were going into the, you know, whatever rocket they were going to take off in, the astronauts in space. But he actually went in and then slid down. So there's obviously an escape hatch that they could get these people out of the way and then send the rocket up and let whatever happens, happens.
Yeah. Nice. Oh, in fact, I had a discussion with a guy just today where he was saying, you know, he said, do you think they even put astronauts on top of the rockets at all? And I go, man, I wouldn't have. Why risk it? As a matter of fact, all I would have done is put him in a capsule, put that capsule like on a C-130 or a C-140, a big bomber, you know, and, you know, no different than the Capricorn 1 movie. Yep. You know, fly them over the ocean, drop it out, make sure there's some burn marks on the capsule, and there you go. Why risk it? On the other hand, though, if the rocket explodes on the pad, well, it's unfortunate because at that point you have to, same thing with Capricorn 1, you'd have to get rid of the astronauts.
Yeah, and so then we got Virgil Grissom, I believe that was his first
name. Gus Grissom. Yeah.
Yeah, and you know he hung a lemon in the window.
On a coat hanger, very famous story. He was the only astronaut that said, that looked at the technology. He was smart enough. Not only was a heck of a pilot, but he was good enough to, you know, look at the technology and say, look, I don't know what you think you're going to do, but there's no way we're going to the moon. And he was public about it, you know, and that's, you know, obviously a death sentence. And so sure enough, the rocket, you know, blows up on the pad, whether or not he was on it or not. Is irrelevant because, you know, he died and the two guys that were with him, I can't remember their names. I'm sorry. No lack of respect there. Yeah. And And that was a lesson, you know, there's your example. Any other astronauts at that point, you know, from that point until today, you could use him. It's like, remember Gus Grissom? Good. Shut up.
Yeah. Yeah. I agree with that because if they've had to keep this thing quiet. So now we looked at the space shuttle. Let's, International Space Station. I look at those things. I mean, it's clearly, why is it long and thin? Because if they're doing it on the Vomit Comet, they're doing it on the 777.
Yeah.
And you can actually see where someone's shirt picks up and he bends over at the waist like he's in a harness.
Yeah.
And the ladies with their hairsprayed hair. I mean, once you see it this way, you can't see it any other way.
No, it is embarrassing. And for those people that don't understand what that is, you know, just look up on YouTube. I don't remember who. I think Eric's got one of them out there called ISS Hoax, and it is embarrassing, the production value that they're putting on the ISS. I've never seen anything. Yeah, first thing you look at, there's three things. First thing is, why is no shot wider than a commercial airliner? Ever. And you think, you know, it's a space station. You can build rooms as big as you want, connect them up, make a big, you know, master control room, piece of cake. You should be able to do that. Two, why are there no hatches between the compartments? Because if you have a single air leak, it's like a submarine. Single air leak, that place is done. Everybody dies. If you have no hatches, people should be in spacesuits constantly. And three, the biggest one, permed hair. They decided to simulate to make sure the anti-gravity, and I know exactly why they did it. It's because if you don't perm the hair, well, I'll give you the alternatives, but if you don't perm the hair, and you can see this in some of the Vomit Comic footage, if you have long hair, what happens is if there's a jostle, turbulence, the woman's head will move to the right or left first, like it's underwater, and then the hair will follow. And so it kind of becomes this marker. It's like, why did she just move to the left? It accentuates why you're moving to the left or right.
Movement. Okay, yeah. So you just brought up, like, as if they're underwater.
Oh yeah, the underwater stuff. Look, just Google Chinese space bubbles. Everybody knows that NASA practices underwater missions by using underwater footage, and they stole what happened was, and blame James Cameron for this, of Titanic, because when he did The Abyss, he figured out how to simulate pure blackness in a giant underwater tank, which was, you just fill the entire top of the pool with black rubber balls and they overlap and they black out all light. And so with that, you can simulate spacewalks. So if you did that, so basically the astronauts are being caught because the internet hive mind has been able to go frame by frame, and they're seeing bubbles. Even though you can get rid of most of the bubbles, there's still going to be, you know, a few little air pockets tucked here and there. And there's you see bubbles every once in a while in some of the astronaut footage. The Chinese was the most obvious, but the Americans, you know, they're out there too. And there's that one shot where, you know, there's a scuba guy, a guy that's leaving the scene in a scuba tank. You only catch the back end of that. It's like, oh my God. Oh, by the way, I know you got stuff to cover, but I wanted to mention one of the ladies that permed her hair, the brunette woman whose hair was referred to as Medusa at one point by one of the internet guys. She just recently cut her hair to the point where, you know, it doesn't move either way. And I said, yeah, that's absolutely one of the three things you would do. You either pull your hair back, you cut your hair, or you wear a NASA hat. They're only $10. Those three things you would choose before perming your hair. Perming your hair, the director, whoever directed that, should be fired.
I know. Oh, yeah. It's like I'd like to have the hairspray concession at NASA. And we could retire.
It's awful. I feel bad for the women. It's like, why would you do that?
Again, why aren't they talking about it? You know, I mean, yeah. That's what I think. When are these people going to come clean? What are they doing? And, you know, okay, let's consider mind control kind of stuff or whatever. But, yeah, really, really, really fascinating stuff that's going on
and,
there.
And can I throw one more thing in there?
Yeah, throw as many things as you want. Go ahead.
If you don't mind, and I don't know if you've seen this, but I didn't realize this until a couple weeks ago, where NASA has been getting beat up so badly, which is, you know, they're backpedaling huge, that they had to create an entire second Wikipedia section that, and I could not make this up if I want to, called independent or third party evidence of Apollo landing, which basically, and they say in the preface, evidence that did not come from NASA or the US government. And it's this big, big section, which basically says, we know that nobody believes the moon landing, but don't take our word for it. Here's some other independent sources that have nothing to do with America that can confirm this, right? And, you know, they mentioned India and China and Japan.
Oh, what? And you don't think all the governments of the world are in on the fix here?
Of course they are. Of course they are. But it's like, it's gotten that bad for NASA, you know, to the point where they're saying, yeah, we know that we have a lot to explain. But here's another, you know, a whole nother thing. And the page is embarrassing because nobody has anything. You know, I try to bring it up, JAXA, the JAXA program, the Japanese space probes that supposedly circled the moon with high def cameras like 5 years ago, which nobody talks about because the footage was so terrible that America, you know, I remember watching it on American news just briefly as they were headed that way, and you never heard anything about it. And then Japan released a few things on YouTube, and it's embarrassing. You know, you see the moon rise, the earth pulling up, you know, it's all got a bunch of clouds on it. You can't see the continents. And you're thinking this is a perfect chance for, you know, some real-time footage of this probe heading back towards Earth. Nothing. Nothing there.
Yeah, that's amazing. But I want to know why, you know, this whole thing that the atmosphere is turning with the Earth and keeps everything, you know, copacetic with this ball Earth, keeps the water stuck onto the Earth. And
it's just,
you know, have you ever taken a flight to Honolulu? I mean,
I have not.
Well, I have. I've done it numbers of times.
Yeah.
And when you leave out, and I check the flight times, and you fly to Honolulu in one direction, technically it should be longer if you're flying with the way the Earth is spinning, because it's the target's getting away from you, right?
Yeah, you know, that argument, and I didn't really touch on it in the videos, but it's a good argument, and that is, if the Earth is spinning, and we'll just use the equator example, is spinning at 1,000 miles an hour, then if a plane is going with the spin, you know, is gravity locking it down? And that's the argument by science. They'll say, well, you know, gravity's locking it down, therefore it's moving with the planet. All right, well, what if the plane's going the other direction against the spin? Same, you know, destination.
You should be able to take a helicopter in one direction to Hawaii, because you just go up in the helicopter and let the Earth move under you and land again.
There is some arguments there. And in fact, they did a Zeppelin test. Oh, geez, I think in Great Britain, because that's exactly what they wanted to do. It's like, we'll have a Zeppelin go to New York. So the question is, why isn't it working? Or and I'll throw this one out too, which is the gravity weight test, which is, if like a merry-go-round, if the Earth is spinning 1,000 miles an hour at the equator, like a merry-go-round, it should be pulling, you know, there should be trying to throw you off. Now, maybe not a lot, but if you're at the North Pole, then on a globe, then the You're spinning at 0 miles an hour, like you were standing in the middle of a merry-go-round. You might get dizzy, but you're not going anywhere. So if you took a 100-pound weight in the North Pole and moved it down to the equator, shouldn't it weigh a little bit less? And you know, scientists say, well, you know, it's not going to weigh much. It's like, fine. So it doesn't weigh 10 pounds less. It's going to weigh a little bit less unless you're saying that the gravity of the planet is completely counteracting entirely centrifugal force.
Well, they're given gravity a whole lot of play here when it's one of the weakest forces in nature, if there is such a thing.
Yeah. And gravity, ask any scientist, gravity is, even on a globe, is still a huge mystery. And
that's because there isn't any.
There you go. Yeah, exactly.
So yeah, that's kind of fascinating there. Yeah. I mean, there's all kinds of things that, you know, we would look at, and people say, how about satellites?
Mm-hmm.
Now, this is a big conjecture. Now, I used to live on Maui, and I had friends that worked up at Haleakala Crater at the observatory up there.
Yep.
And, you know, there's a telescope up there. And their job was to be out in this glass room all night long in parkas, because it's damn cold, and tracking satellites that go by. And people are saying there's no satellites, but I think there has to be something up there.
I've got mixed feelings on this, because I could go either way on a couple things. But but let me start with this. I just on a whim decided, because somebody asked me, they said, hey, you want to have some fun, you know, especially since you're in Colorado, take some night vision binoculars and start looking at the sky. And so I went out with night vision binoculars and Russian made, because they're all made in Russia for whatever reason. And the first night or two, I'm going, wow, there are a lot of satellites up there, because most of which you cannot see with the naked eye. Mm-hmm. But as I was looking more and more, these satellites were doing things that I certainly didn't recognize as satellite behavior. They were making right-hand turns, left-hand turns. They were going ballistic and powering up and powering down and going in, you know, formation, you know, of as few as four, as many as like 12 or 13. And so I'm going, okay, if I'm not looking at satellites, then what am I looking at? You know,
did you film any of this?
That's the tough. Well, there was a guy. It's tough to film in night vision. In fact, I call this my own little private conspiracy, and that is, why don't any night vision binoculars have video output? I know they're made in Russia, but there's, you know, we have the tech to output to anything. But there's a guy out there, if you want to look it up on YouTube, his name was Magnet Flipper, and he lived down a ways from me, maybe 90 or so miles. And so we were looking at the exact same stuff. And he was on YouTube for a while and mentioned some things. And, you know, and then he just disappeared off the map. He was one of the few guys that actually got footage of some of this stuff. And it's gorgeous stuff. Now, you'll be able to find, there's some other people out there that can film a night vision. But to do it, you can't use binoculars. You have to use a night vision scope, a monocular and a camera, and hope you get lucky. You know, you basically have to just keep, you know, like the guy down in Australia, he just lets it run and then, you know, edits the footage from there. But anyway, the point was, is that, yeah, there's a lot of stuff up there, but it's not satellites. Now,
what is it?
Well, that's just, it. I don't think it's us. If it is, I mean, there's a lot of traffic. I mean, the sky is crawling with stuff. And most of it you cannot see with the naked eye. But when it comes to...
That's like the broken tether video that Dave and Sarita made.
Yeah. The broken tether video, that's a tough one, because depending on where it was shot... you know, you question, okay, is it real? Is it fake? Because, you know, were they actually in orbit or were they not in orbit? Yeah, that's a freaky video. I've watched that a whole bunch of times, and it almost looks like we're underwater. You know, it's a strange, anyway.
Yeah.
But satellites are tricky, because here's my problem. If you're faking people in the ISS station, why are you doing it? Because, you know, at that point, satellites become very much in doubt, because, all right, we have the technology to put people in orbit. That's not the tough part. But if you can't put them in orbit, then what is up there? You know, are they literally throwing satellites away and compensating with other devices?
But they're certainly at a low orbit.
Exactly. Yeah. Is there some sort of thing when they get up there? Is there a technology being used to where they're just flying in a giant circle? It's tough to say, but literally above spy planes, I have doubts about everything above that, because, again, it comes back to the ISS. It's like, look, we have the ability to put people at that altitude. So if you're faking that, is there, you know, is the reason for that the, you know, does that carry over into satellites? Is, you know, at that point it's like, okay, can you put anything up there?
Well,
you know,
that calls GPS into question.
GPS, which was built by the United States military, went online in 1995, I believe. That puts GPS in. And for me, it was a little different from NASA, but GPS system, it for me, was a wonderful way of covering what the Earth looked like, because then you could control, well, not only could you see where people were, but you could steer them where you wanted to, because everyone trusts the GPS as gospel. So if the GPS says you're here, then you're there. But what if you're not there? You know what, you know, people ask me, you know, like, you know, before GPS, you know, Amelia Earhart, did she go down because, you know, because the map was wrong, you know, and she didn't have GPS to fly by. But yeah, the GPS system is completely in question. Is it real at all? Because yeah, the GPS is supposed to be based
people
on.
People say no, it's just antennas that are triangulating.
Exactly. Yeah. And that, I mean, there's an article on the BBC where they, you know, because they were asking about the Malaysia flight thing, and they're saying, oh, yeah, GPS has problems in the Southern Hemisphere, you know.
They're admitting the Southern Hemisphere problem.
Yeah. And I'm just going, why would you have problems in the Southern Hemisphere? It's a global positioning system, and it's an American system. America doesn't do anything small. They're going to build massive systems. They're going to put extra satellites if they could do that. So
okay, let's talk about. Let's talk about the midnight sun, okay? I have friends that live in Alaska, North Pole, Scandinavia. They all get midnight sun in the summer. The sun doesn't set in those summer months. If this was a globe and it was the way they said, then South America, places like Patagonia and stuff, should have midnight sun as well, but you don't hear anyone talking about midnight sun in our winter in South America.
Excellent point. Very, very good point. And depending on what, and unfortunately, there's not a lot of models. There's just a handful of models out there on the internet that show what you're talking about. But it is, yeah, if you see the sun and the moon, depending on how the light is shining and the angle, you're exactly right. There, you should have that phenomena in both places. But they don't. They don't talk about it. You know, what is more often than not is they will avoid, you know, no different than why aren't there any stars on the moon during the Apollo missions. They will avoid it entirely. They will take it completely out of the conversation. Therefore, why would you ever bring up the question?
Yeah, I know. It's kind of interesting. Yeah. But, you know, and back to Capricorn 1, like I said, I'm old enough that I saw that in the theaters.
Okay.
And I think what they say is whoever this ruling class is that's, mm-hmm. you know, perpetuating these hoaxes –
sure.
They have a code that they live with themselves, lets them live with themselves, that they say they have to tell the truth somewhere. And so I think I think they hide a lot of it in plain sight in Hollywood. And then people just kind of say, oh, well, that was just a movie.
Yeah. It's funny because, yeah, you hide a few nuggets. You hide in plain sight because people, if you can, well, I'll give you two examples. One, of course, was the clue I did where I said, you know, again, why nobody else talked about this, you know, the fact that there's never been a Hollywood movie made about the moon missions ever. And
never been a remake, you know, I mean, we're remake city. You brought. There's a remake of everything.
Yeah, but when you ask people, and I've done this to people, I say, oh, yeah, you remember that movie about the moon missions? And people immediately say, oh, yeah. I go, really, what was it? And then they'll start, you know, the gears will start going in their heads, and then they'll say, huh, because everything that they remember was a science fiction movie of some sort. It was either Red Planet or 2001 A Space Odyssey or you know, even a stretch. You know, some guy says, what about Apollo 18? I'm going, dude, that was little rock crab monsters on the moon. That's not a real movie. You know, it's not a documentary, but that just shows you the length of the deception. It's not like it's not that they're just controlling fact. They're influencing fiction to a point where they will not let a Hollywood studio make one of those movies. Capricorn 1 fell through the cracks. A major studio never picked that up. That was an independent film done by a CBS executive guy. And because he was angry about how the Apollo missions were being displayed on television. Because he used to work in a television studio, he was going, "This is the worst production value I've ever seen in my life."
They were horrible. I remember being in. I was probably in junior high or eighth and ninth grade for that, And everybody's gathered on the TV. I go, what's so interesting about this? It was terrible.
Yeah, it's grainy. It was second generation. Yeah. All the studios, all the television networks complained bitterly. They said, why can't we get a live feed? Nobody talks about why they couldn't get a live feed. And when they made Capricorn One in 1979, which was the highest grossing independent film of that year, they got away with it because, you know, even the conspiracy circles weren't really that organized. The internet was still 15, 20 years away. They could never make that movie now. Never in a million years. And every time I see it on cable, I am just stunned that they're putting it out there because really, because they're showing you how they're doing it right there.
Well, I think that's their code. They want to show you because that's how they check their brain, if their brainwashing is working.
There you go. Yeah.
And they've got in, you know, so much is coming out right now. And I think people that listen to our kind of radio and what have you, you get what I call horizontal fatigue. I mean, just one issue is enough for a lifetime study.
Yeah.
You know, like studying 9/11.
You could spend your entire life doing 9/11.
But they overwhelm us. And so at a certain point in time, and people say, I've heard you say that, oh, you can't say everything's fake. I can. The first director of the CIA said, we'll know our disinformation campaign is complete when everything the American public believes is false. I say they've pretty much accomplished that.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Which is what makes the conspiracy world so tough, because there's so – in fact, it's not even just that things are faked. It's how many layers are involved. And I don't want to go into, you know, the other conspiracies necessarily, but you know what I'm talking about. I mean, where, you know, you've got people arguing over, well, let's throw one out there. Were there planes or were there not planes? Because the first layer doesn't even touch that argument. And, you know, they just, it's like, oh, yeah.
Yeah. Not planes. Something else.
Yeah. There you go.
Yeah. Something else. So, I mean, but of course, yeah, I know the whole thing stinks.
Yeah.
And why? So what is it? Why do they enjoy lying to us in so much?
Is it enjoying, or is it one of those challenge things? You know, where it's like, Tavistock. Yeah. I mean, it's a tough call because, you know, yeah, there might be some sadism absolutely involved, but the other thing is, you know, they think, oh, well, it's for their own good. And it's like, really? Because you seem to be, you know, creating an awful lot of it under – and the fear stuff is the stuff that bugs me the most. Why create fear, you know, fear-induced stuff that all it does is creates increased stress levels for people? Those are the ones that drive me insane. There's no need for it unless, you know, there's something, you know, deeper and darker behind it, which I probably don't want to get into.
Yeah. Well, I agree. We're coming up on the top of the hour here, Mark, and we've had a great conversation.
I'm glad.
And I hope that you will contact Eric Dubay.
I absolutely
start having a public conversation with him, so we can stop this nonsense and move this forward, so people can start to know.
I'd like to.
You know, because you know what we say: in God we trust; everyone else we monitor.
Oh, that's good. Where'd you get that?
That comes from Tony Woody's squadron. That's what it says on their patch. They flew the P-3 and the spy planes, and that was their patch. And God trust, everyone else we monitor.
That's great. Oh, yeah. By the way, I want to – let me comment on that real quick, because people say, well, you know, the government, you know, can't keep a secret and blah, blah, blah. It's like, well, you know, this is spy plane reference. Before the U-2 spy plane was shot down, there was no spy plane. The SR-71 Blackbird went from birth to retirement without ever being talked about, ever. And nobody, you know, and then my favorite thing was when they retired it, they came out and publicly said, oh, yeah, by the way, we're retiring our Blackbird spy plane. It's like, what spy plane? And then they said, what are you replacing with it? And the Air Force guy goes, oh, nothing. it's like, oh, you're killing me.
Yeah.
So, yeah, the government can keep secrets. And but for me, this one, you know, which is why I have a ray of hope here, is this is a secret so big that I think they knew full well they couldn't keep it forever because we live here. And, you know, it was sooner or later, this thing, and I'm sure they have contingency plans. This thing was never going to be forever.
Well, I think I hope that's true, because I mean, Wendy and I have big mouths. We can't stop talking about this. I mean, really, and people get it. I mean, that's the amazing thing. Like, you know, she everyone laughs. I mean, when you first say flat earth, they go laugh. I was screaming on the inside when I heard it, but she laughed, and I made her stay on the phone with me while she watched videos.
Wow.
Yeah, I made her stay on the phone. I just said, you're going to watch this right now. And you heard her reaction. It jeopardized our friendship because now she can't stop looking at it.
But
she has converts. She has loads of converts. So, Mark Sargent, thank you so much. Mark Sargent, Flat Earth Clues on YouTube. Kiss and make up with Eric Dubé, I hope.
I'm going to try.
And we'd love to have you on sometime.